10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Dire team ban. Radiant team ban. Dire team ban. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Radiant team pick. Dire team pick.
Invoker.
Dire team pick.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. It's our second series of the day, Team Alternate Attacks versus Team Ad Finem. I've got Blaze casting with me. Hello, Blaze.
Hey, man, how's it going?
Good. Good. It's been a while, dude. It's been a while. Been a busy beaver, I take it.
Witch doctor. Yeah. A lot of stuff behind the scenes. Not as much on the microphone as I'd like to be. So it's fun to always get in here and cast some Dota. And, I mean, this match should be pretty good. Ad Finem versus Alternate. Obviously, Ad Finem have been doing a lot of work in the European scene recently, and Alternate, while they didn't play that well in their most recent match against Liquid, they have been able to take games off of some tough teams, so it's going to be a pretty dynamic matchup, and I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, this definitely, this is the other side of the lower bracket matches. We just got done watching No Diggity defeat Danish Bears and knock them out of the tournament. Now, obviously, we have our chance to see which one of these two teams is going to be moving forward to face up against Team Spirit. That is who else is in the lower bracket currently waiting their next opponent. I'm kind of siding here with Ad Finem. I just think the guys from Ad Finem, they are just a little bit better than Team Alternate Attacks, but I think this match is relatively even, and I guess could go either way. I think it's more like a 60-40 matchup.
Definitely. I think that Ad Finem is favored for sure, but I would say it's less about how well they executed their play, and more just how well their strategy seems to work out. Like, I love the action that Spartan puts out on the map early, whether he's playing the Earth Spirit, which got banned out, or this Wisp. He's going to be able to make some activity happen on pretty much a full relocate cycle, and with a Batrider behind that, like, you've got guaranteed initiation on some clear targets. So you get a kill on a core pretty much every 90 seconds. Madara loves to pick up carries that farm fast, so you see this Fen being banned out here. I just feel like Ad Finem are really good at building an economic advantage very early on and kind of just controlling the map and snowballing it the way the European Dota generally has as a win condition.
For those guys who don't know who Ad Finem is, this is the old London Conspiracy that went, I think to date, their biggest win was against Evil Geniuses in the MLG, the second season of the MLG Joint Dota League Finals, which was at the X Games in Austin, Texas. I think that was their biggest win, where they managed to go into the playoffs, and I believe they got fourth. They went into the third place matchup, I think, against like LGD or maybe it wasn't, but it was someone. It was someone actually pretty good, and I think they ended up taking. Oh, I think it was Fnatic actually. I'm not sure why LGD popped into my head, but I'm pretty sure it was Fnatic. They ended up getting, but yeah, they've been around the block a little ways. Of course, so is Team Alternate Attacks, though they are very young players. They've actually been playing together for quite some time. We had Team Alternate Attacks here at the defense. Got a chance to meet some of those guys and get to know them a little bit. They're very nice, very quiet, very, very quiet group. So both of these teams have kind of made their way from, I think, tier 3 to tier 2. We'll see as, like, the European scene kind of settles down, whether that continues, or if both ATN and Finnum are just essentially taking advantage of the fact that the other European teams haven't really found. I guess we'll see as this scene progresses. Team Alternate Attacks are going to get themselves a Doom as well as faces Void, while Ad Finnum have the Bane and Tiny. Of course, the Bane to make up for the lack of disables that the Wisp brings to the table, and the Tiny Wisp combination. So, comboed with the Batrider, you're right, this should be some really easy pickoff material against anybody, even the faceless Void. Just the disables they bring in, the short amount of burst damage, they could easily lasso, relocate in, and get the wombo combo from the Tiny to finish faceless Void off. So This is looking scary for Team Alternate Attacks, but I do like the way they drafted the Doom against
him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's actually a Kakko favorite as a four-position Doom. He's able to make a lot happen early and make the most of like the early Devour play and stuff like that. So I do like the Doom pickup here, but it is interesting that now they have absolutely no response to the Batrider, other than maybe the Invoker has a Yule Scepter, maybe a Chrono, the solo Batrider, just to stop that initiation, but otherwise everything else is just way too slow. So, yeah, I'll see how they kind of deal with this Batrider threat, if the Batrider does get the blink relatively early. But if Alternate Attacks are the ones initiating, if they're ones breaking out of smoke, popping their ultimates, I actually feel like they have the teamfight advantage. They do have some really great Wombo Combo ultimates in the Chrono plus Death Ward plus Meteor, and then of course the Doom, which you just could never count out. So more often than not, you're going to have to Doom the Wisp in this context, because of course otherwise you're just going to see the IO relocate the Doomed target out, and
true.
They'll just buy time, 12 seconds, they'll get right back into it, full health and ready to function.
Alright, so what are our last picks, though? Team Alternate Attacks still need a safe lane carry, Ad Finnum. I actually also need that to combo with the Bane. I guess it doesn't really need to combo with the Bane necessarily, but it would be nice. What do you think in place?
I mean, it doesn't really have to be a hard carry. They can still kind of be confident in their late game with just Batrider and Tiny, especially when he's fueled by the Wisp. Those heroes can do quite a bit at the latter stages. So I feel like kind of a tempo core would suit them well, where it's not like hardcore you have to farm for 30 minutes to come online. It's just somebody that gets involved in the fights early and they can get their hands dirty. Because Ad Finnum, while they usually put Madara on a core that can farm very quickly, and Tiny can be considered that. He's actually doesn't usually play the Tiny as much as their alternative, maybe next time. But I don't know. It's just one thing I'm noting is that most of their wins, especially of recent times, are 30-minute games or less. So I still feel like you can snowball it. You might farm quickly. The Gyrocopter was something they could have picked up themselves, but I feel like they still want to make sure that the game ends sooner rather than later. So you could look maybe towards a Juggernaut that can do pretty good. Not really at killing the Void, but at least putting some good damage into him, and then pushing the tower very, very early.
Weaver is the last Radiant choice here for Team Alternate Attacks, trying to get something that is a little bit slippery. And okay, that is actually a London Conspiracy favorite. That is definitely a thug hero through and through. It's a lockdown against the Weaver, so it seems like they were already thinking about that hero, and they picked up Weaver, and they're like, oh, all right, great, our Windranger works even better now. But I like this. It's kind of an aggressive core, as you said. They didn't need to go fall back on like a real hard carry. They could actually still pick up something aggressive. I think Windranger fits the build, still progresses into late game if necessary, but I like the fact that it also is a hero that can push, help push towers, which
absolutely.
I think is kind of important.
Yeah, and it's just like, at this point, you don't really have a very easy Doom target. Just going into it, you're like, okay, well, obviously I have to be worried about the relocate back from the Wisp, but you want to get the Doom out of the Windranger, but if she just wind runs right before the Doom comes out, then you could still get the distance you need, and it's not going to be that big of a deal. I'm actually curious how much of an impact Hackor's Doom is really going to have, because he's going to go boots first, he's going to look for some early camps and some early harassment around level 2, but... You know, most of the time, you draft a Doom, and you're like, okay, well, as long as I get the Doom out on a good target in a fight, we win the fight. That's 90% of the time going to be the case. But here, I feel like Advenom can play around it a little bit, and it's going to be kind of frustrating for them to really secure the kills until the Invoker builds up his Exhort.
So the Windranger's going to be matched up against Supreme's Invoker. Looks like they're going to go for the contest here at the top lane and leave Madara alone to claim that bounty rune at bottom. I can't say I'm that confident. Doom is about a bad level 1 hero, but Witch Doctor and Weaver are definitely not bad. They're already starting off the Sticky Napalm. They're going to go ahead and tether onto Skylark. Maybe next time's going to run Ramboing on in. They get a really good paralyzing cast, but they do manage to get to pick up the bounty rune, but doesn't really matter. At least Sach is still going to end up going down as your first blood. The bounty hunter, Batrider, is going to go down to Exotic Deer, who's now going to get some damage onto Spartan. Maybe next time. Challenging Kaycor even more now, as he's got that value brain sap level 1. It's really tough for anybody to fight him one-on-one. So in the end, it looks like Advenom did come out on top solely because they managed to get the first blood. Unfortunately, they didn't get the bounty rune at top lane, or else that would have been a very clean win from them. But I think they're willing to exchange the Batrider for that big boost of gold. Who picked it up, by the way? Bang.
The Witch Doctor. The Bang at the first blood, yes. And then the Witch Doctor got the bounty. But up top, Weaver's actually going to be going in pretty hard onto Skylark here. And we're going to be seeing this very frequently, especially if Exotic Deer is able to get the Geminate out pretty soon. The Wisp is actually going to essentially have to babysit the Batrider and turn it into a 2v2, because the Batrider won't otherwise get very much out of the lane. Just the strength of the Witch Doctor flank and such, and they're going to go again.
Paralyzing cast bounces back to Skylark, and that should be a kill. Spartan just not separating himself enough in those trees. That the paralyzing cask bounces right on back over to him, and then the Batrider again. Unfortunate matchup there. Mid lane, Thug is getting some good harassment damage onto Supreme, who's very rapidly running low on regen. Only has one shared tingle left, 2 fairy fires though.
Yeah, I think that they were trying to go for a bit of a bait play where when Spartan's in the trees like that, he can pop a fairy fire and then a healing salve and keep the Batrider alive a lot longer than you normally expect. And with the longer cooldown on Chikuchi early on, maybe you can kind of turn it against Exotic Deer and punish him. But that, like you said, the cast separation as well as just how strictly low the Batrider was, it definitely wasn't what they were looking for. And the lane just gets harder from here. But overall, I mean, I think that Alternate had the right early idea with this top lane and with that room fight. It's put damage into the Batrider. The Batrider can do so much work if he just gets to keep casting spells, keep flying around. Oh, mid.
Well, not only was the Forge Spirit doing a little blocking, but so was the Doom. Managed to soak up some of those Spirit Balls. They will get a lot of turn damage here. In fact, Kaycor's got to be careful. Doesn't get hit by the power shot, but still, Spartan and Thug will come out on top in that engagement. And that trade of damage. Bottom lane, unfortunately, miss out on that one, but it looks like a sleep led into a brain sap tiny combination. That's so much burst damage. The tiny is already bad enough, but then you include another bit of pure burst there from the brain sap, and Nisha didn't stand much of a chance.
Yeah, against this kind of a lane, I actually think you go Belt of Strength first, even before the boots, because you're not going to be able to like trade with the Bane anyways, moving back and forth. So just get that raw HP, and then when you need to regen, you can drop it in the trees and use the healing salve. So I think, yeah, Belt of Strength will help a lot in terms of just living through one or two combos so they kind of exhaust this mana pool.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those lanes. Like, if they don't one-shot you, you're going to time walk everything off. So you'll go right back up to full HP. The Tiny doesn't have a huge mana pool, so he can't like regularly do those kind of combinations. I think you're absolutely right. And Nisha does need to be careful. Has to pull these tangos pretty early. to make sure he always stays near 100% max mana pool because it's tiny. Now picking up his treads, also still has the mango available, and you can see right now they actually are ready to go at any point in time. If Nietzsche just puts himself in the wrong position, they'll go for another sleep combination of their own.
Yeah, so it's going to be, I guess, hard for both offlaners, but of course Skylar gets the advantage of being able to jungle. He's going to be able to get like one or two stack camps and still get a really fast blink dagger, and it's going to be about the time that Spartan gets his relocate. I mean, this guy's already a third of the way through level 3, so the Wisp is going to be able to make gank plays happen at the same time that the Batrider is looking to find kills. And for Alternate, they have to be very scared about that. I mean, the Invoker's not going to have Wex for some time. Sure, the Weaver of the Void can dodge away from relocates pretty early on if the lasso isn't there prior to it, leading into it, but the Invoker is just so vulnerable, and he's going to need a lot of vision to keep him safe.
Surprised still no Shackle Shot on Thug. Goes for the extra value level of Windrun. Despite he's going up against the Exord Invoker, which Ford Spirits very oftentimes are just kind of free Shackle Shots, but...
I think this shows that they don't expect to get too many ganks on mid early. The fact is, Windrunning against the Ford Spirit is just as effective as shackling with and against them. I definitely see the potential value of Shackle Shot, but if the Bane's never coming mid, then I guess there's not enough value in it. So just trading, and trading efficiently.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think this build is a lot more like harassment focused and focusing on like just trading very efficiently with the Invoker rather than actually going for that, going for a kill on him. So, a little bit just difference of philosophy, but this does kind of show up what Advenom expect from their, oh man, that Witch Doctor just got the most value paralyzing task I've seen in just a random scenario like that. Skylark's gonna drop pretty low here. The Sun Strike! Oh!
Really?
It doesn't quite hit him, and now Skylark can actually turn and fight in this situation, slowing down K'Kor. He still has the Scorched Earth that is gonna be able to keep that movement speed slightly ahead of the Batrider, combined with the Mixed Flame Break. That is going to be a clean escape from him, still.
So I find it interesting that Tiny is actually going to be going for drums before a blink dagger, and the idea there is like obviously the quick jump, Batrider blinking in, Tiny blinking in on a target, like you could go for such quick kills on somebody with or without relocate. With this, he's much more tethered to the Wisp. He has to make sure that the Spartan's with him. The Spartan is the taxi Radiant's service that brings him into the fight. But of course, he gets more throughput. He can push powers faster. The attack speed is the bread and butter of a Tiny with Bro. So it's definitely going to be valuable. It's just going to be a different style. It's not going to be just kind of gung ho tower diving. It's still going to be some pretty consistent damage output.
Clearing through some stacks. Spartan. Gonna help out Madara here with a bit of regeneration. Meanwhile, top lane, ATN are trying to pressure this tier 1 tower while the Batrider is away. They know he's gonna be, can the Wisp actually do this? I just now noticed. Setting up for the double stack here. Pulls a hard camp, pulls a medium camp. You get them both? He does. Nicely played. No, that's not the, you know, the big play in the world, but that's just a nice little bit of value micro there from Spartan that he was able to pull that off.
Absolutely. And this is going to just keep building up Madara very quickly. He's going to not only have the drums, but then rapidly move into his next item. Ags obviously is going to be the time where Madara shifts into like full demolition mode, but at least for now, I think they're still going to be focusing on ganks, focusing on early kills, because Alternate is a pretty greedy lineup that you want to be able to punish. I mean, getting kills early on an Invoker or a Weaver really sets them back. And so, with Supreme getting this, jump
is
good.
Looks like Thug is dead. Looks like he ran out of mana. Didn't have enough for Windrun.
Yeah, and he also just didn't see that play coming. Like, it was just straight up, like, the Sunstrike of was so, like, Sunstrike Cold Snap all the way back here. The Invoker was as unmenacing as possible, was very passive, was very far back, just one of the Windranger to feel comfortable, but the thing is, Windranger still has a pretty low HP pool, so an ability like Sunstrike at level 4, getting that on a stationary target, suddenly, you get a freebie.
Oh, Nisha. He's gonna run right into this one. He has a Chronosphere ready to go too. He's gonna kill Spartan and might get Madara as well. There's a Sunstrike up. I'm not sure why he's not throwing it. Invoker? Hello?
Okay. Now he doesn't have vision. Hmm.
Man, that should have been a double if he throws the Sunstrike on the Tiny while they have the Chronosphere.
Yeah. I mean, it might have been like within the last 5 seconds of cooldown, but I would have at least seen him throw it sometime after, just for the chance.
Alright, there's our Blink Dagger from the Batrat. I did like this. This was just like a little bit of a twist from the typical farming Tiny for Ad Finem, the way that they just systematically clear through the jungle with Bane's Dagger. Well, they should die. TP out, no? No bash!
Wow. Okay.
Anyway, the cool part of that was that they opened up the safe lane for Bane. And Bane obviously getting level 6 can mean free kills. Madara just runs into this three-man crew that they saw earlier, tosses the Doom back to the Wisp. Gotta be careful though, the Death Ward is already laid out. Fortunately, there's no Chronosphere. Sunstrike lands and the Wisp ends up going down. They have another combo here. They're gonna hit both these heroes, but I don't think he can pop anybody here. And the Witch Doctor's Restoration is going to cause some problems. They have another toss. Toss Nisha. Toss a Greep. Gets him. Doom ends up going down, but in the mid lane, Invoker goes down to the first reveal of the Blink Dagger. I just wanted to follow Madara and see whether or not. Oh, he gets the toss onto. Oh, he gets a two! Madara somehow pulls a double kill out of his ass. I have no idea where that came from. Now he's dead, though.
If he sold his, like, bought it the side job and was able to blink out despite being under damage, that would have been insanely good, but it's still great just to get the kills there, the Doom and the Void, even if the Witch Doctor walks away. And you got the Invoker on top. So suddenly, three kills coming out for Ad Finem. At the exact timing, they're starting to look to peak. I mean, Spartan is going to be funding his relocate with this next creep wave. They have the Radiant Lasso coming back up in 40 seconds, so it's just going to be pressure from this point forward. And they're going to look for offensive wards. No wards, surprisingly. They're just looking for a Fiendscript play.
Man, if they just kept on going towards that hard camp, they may still get the Invoker. They see him farming. They know it's going to be dependent on Supreme's reaction time, and he's just not fast enough. So the Fiend's Grip, Focus Fire combination. Now they should be able to wrap onto mid, too. In fact, Potter is going to jump forward here, going for the Doom. Doesn't have the burst damage by himself. Unfortunately, the Tether went before the Blink. Otherwise, maybe Spartan could have helped him out there with a couple of Spirit Hits. But as it is, they still put pressure on the Doom, they've killed the Invoker, and they might be able to take this tier 1 tower, but it doesn't look like ATN is going to let them have it. Bottom
tower is under attack. I mean, they're going to try to hold it, but really, what do they have to work with here? They have the Chrono Death Ward, and that's mostly it. I mean, Tiny going in again.
Jesus, I did not expect him to go back in like that, especially since it's going to cost him his life unless they relocate to the side. They get the save.
Interesting spot.
Yeah, he took him just to the tier 1, I guess hoping to be able to keep him in. Oh! Oh, if they tanked that Sunstrike together, they both live, but Madara was barely outside of the ring there and does end up dodging it while the Wiz takes the full blunt of that one. Skylark, he did go down to the bottom lane to stop Exotic Dero. It's watching him just kind of do a little bit of split pushing, but now looks like he's going to be caught out here. There's just no escape. Paralyzing Cast does not stop. Keep some permastun.
These are some big kills for Alternate, honestly. Like, this is a time where they shouldn't be able to fight as effectively because they don't have the Doom yet, and yet they're still finding kills all over the place, and they're going to be able to finish off the bottom tier 1. So they can start farming the eastern part of the Radiant Jungle when Ad Finem want to be ganking the Dire side. So, Gracie is shackled up top, but the Scorched Earth will nullify most of that, and there is no relocate. So, I mean, it's interesting because, like, every lane has some kill potential, some ability to just jump in and blow somebody up, but unless there's the Batrider or the Wisp involved, it doesn't seem like they have enough follow through. So any safe farming space for Alternate is a huge boon for them. Dire's structures are fortified.
It's like a Dire's full rotation up to the top lane. Attack. Kaycor, I believe he knows that this is dangerous, hiding behind the tier 1. Meanwhile, ATN, I thought for a second they might consider going Roshan during this time, if they have the idea that Ad Finem is pressuring top with multiple heroes, but they're actually going to two-man smoke, rotate, and try and put a stop to this push. They're not fast enough to save the tower, but they may still be able to catch somebody, or not. Full TP's out from Ad Finem, and they dodge the gank.
Yeah. And that's quite unfortunate, because, I mean, obviously they just got that doom. Now they're looking for any chance to initiate, and smokes are going to become very valuable for alternate over the next few minutes. They've only got one left in stock, one left on the doom. Those two smokes are going to be defining whether alternate can get into the mid-game, because right now I feel like Adfinum are dramatically ahead. I mean, the net worth does show Weaver on top, and the graphs show them equal, but Adfinum have so many ways to get to the next stage as far as objectives, as far as kill potential, and they're only getting started.
Batrider's still trying to finish up that four staff. He's gonna need it too, because his exotic deer almost has his Lincoln Sphere. Nisha, wrapping around behind this tier 1 tower, has his Chronosphere. Also happens to have a double damage, but their vision is being taken away, maybe next time. Scores the kill on that ward before his counter dies. It looks like the enemy counter is just barely in range of this ward too, so they really need to be able to protect this mid and take out that counter ward before ATN have a chance to push the high ground again. Skylark going for his pickoff. He's gonna run into the Weaver here. This is perfect. But unfortunately for him, it's kind of a weird ward.
Yeah.
But it's barely outside from blocking. I'm just so surprised it's not like somewhere in this area, you know? To see more of the river. But it does manage to scout out the Batrider before the Weaver gets caught.
And, I mean, any approach from the west, like you're most commonly going to be seeing at least one member of Adfinum coming through this western front, trying to get into the central jungle. That's going to be the key area. That with these two wards covering it, they only have to worry about a southern entry, and that's far less common unless the enemy's smoking. Especially when you have the tier 1 up right there. So, yeah, I don't think that they're going to have to worry about a southern entry, and they're just trying to get any safe farming space. The Midas is going to start kicking in for the Invoker pretty soon. And obviously he's going to look for that max exhort before he goes for the big fight. But there's that smoke, one of two. And they need a kill with this, I think.
Looks like they're going to put priority on shutting down Moderate.
If they relocate the Tiny out here, that would be so disastrous.
Yeah, this would definitely be the worst case scenario. But K-Core has positioned himself to be able to get the Doom on a Spartan. In fact, they just throw out the Inferno Blade and Doom up Moderate instead. Looks like they should be able to get both kills here. Maybe next time, unable to stop anything. And now comes their Chronosphere as they surround the Bane. Will easily be able to get that kill. And unfortunately, they can't just turn and take this tier 2. Adfinum already knowing that they need to try and pressure the top lane in order to, because ATN are going to go straight for Roshan, it looks like. So, if they're going to go for Roshan, you need to try and take this tier 2 to try and offset the clear advantage that ATN has just got.
Critical backstab movement from K-Core and plus one. Like, you cannot go for just the Tiny on the front line. And they didn't even see it until, like, it developed. Like, instantly they react, instantly move into the tier 2 tower. The Tiny had only just become visible, and they're like, nope, don't bother. That's not going to be the thing. It's going to be the Blitz behind him. And that's what they got. So, very nice executed. 3 kills and a Rosh. It looks like they'll lose the top tower, but, I mean, obviously, what alternate we're looking for. Mid.
Madara trying again, man, with his attack speed, the drums, playing those bongos, he does manage to get the attack speed necessary to kill the Doom. But unfortunately, his Aghanim's has been set back.
I think it's okay timing. I mean, the drum blink came out quickly enough because of the kills that he got on bottom lane. That probably should have happened. So it's not bad timing, but yeah, I mean, he hasn't really been able to sync up with the Wisp as much as he wants to. In fact, I'd say it mostly falls on the fact that Spartan is 0-4-2. Like, most of the real K plays haven't been all that successful. The Wisp only has 2 points in overcharge right now. I don't feel like they're fully confident in the Tiny combo unless, Batrider finds that surprise jump that he's looking for up top.
Yeah. With the 4 staff he has, he can actually get a lasso on Exotic Deer, and they can follow that up with a relocate. But Exotic Deer needs to be solo for this to happen, and it seems like ATN, they know the Batrider is going to be ganking them, and that's why they're just baiting out El Isash. It's not really an important kill, and they'll be able to perform again this backstab where they might be able to catch something here. Thug's going to be chased down. Skylark is going to be Chronosphere. That is a very dead Batrider, so we know he's dead. Let's hop out of a Thug, who is still going to go down. Looks like the wind run not going to be enough to save him. And now Weaver is immediately going to TP down to the bottom lane and try and kill Spartan, who's going to go for the TP out, but that's just not going to be fast enough. Double kill and a godlike spree for Exotic Deer. He is going all out in this map.
Yeah, the Batrider jump was just not what they were looking for, and as such, the Tiny Wisp just weren't there. Like, that was in no way the initiation they were looking for. It's very unfortunate that Windranger actually goes down too, because she's definitely worth a good chunk of change to the Weaver there, and Weaver's going to be able to get the, not only Desolator, but later on MKB that much more quickly to just obliterate the Windranger. She can't even really get into the fight if she's worried about Doom and an MKB.
KB catching maybe next time. He should be dead. Tries to go for the sleep suicide. Doesn't happen. That'll now be a tier 1. And mid lane down, that's going to mean Ad Venom. They'd already had a hard time controlling their jungle. It's going to get even worse now as ATN continue their push. Moderus got the Axe. Big upgrade in damage, but ATN, they're about to hit a really big peak with this Desolator coming in for the Weaver.
I wonder if they can contest the stack, though. I'm sure they've seen this ancient stack. They know how big it is for the Tiny, but I don't really feel like with the Chronosphere on cooldown and with them kind of going back to heal, that they're going to be able to keep as much space control over this area as they'd like to. So yeah. Looks like they're just going to have to let that go. But overall, they've still been doing so well this game. Oh, bat? No, not going to pick.
Plus, it's the fact that it's like when you get this farmed on Tiny, it's like a Sven doing it. You know, you just do it so quickly. Looks like they might be able to contest some of these bigger creeps. Nisha is going to be hit by the Fiend's Grip, though. He's very dead. They are getting some of the bigger creeps in process, but now they just got lassoed onto Supreme. They pulled him up to the high ground, too. That means Supreme may end up dying twice, but here comes the stay. Good sleep onto Madara. That actually makes it so the Death Ward is no longer on him, but Exotic Deer still gets the right clicks thanks to the Geminate attack. Is beyond godlike as they finish them up. Yes, Supreme is still stuck on the high ground, but the rest of ATN is winning the fight for him. Maybe next time, no escape here. Literally at a dead end. As ATN, they actually had Finim. They try and go back to see if they can go for Supreme while the Bane is soaking up some attention, but ATN is just a bit too close, and the TP out is successful for the Invoker. Very nasty fight.
It's really tough for Advenom right now. They are not getting big shocker shots like they need to. The Skylark's lassos aren't doing the full job that they need to. In this case, it did pop the Aegis, but didn't do much more than that. Just taking the Invoker out of the fight. And Alternate are just doing so well in these kind of choke point engagements where they usually would struggle. Avalanche, Shackle Shot, these abilities are really good against choke points, and they didn't have their Void to work with because of that Sentry and the Fiend's Grip. But they get in, they get their damage out, and it just seems like Alternate are still able to maneuver really well in spite of a couple of abilities they should be afraid of. And that's a big problem for Advenom as we move forward. They previously were supposed to be on the hunt. Now I feel like Alternate are going to be the ones hunting them.
Yeah, you could definitely see that right now as ATN are again looping around that ancient area, controlling the mid-jungle. They're not going to find anybody yet. Thug trying to go for the split push at top lane, but he only has an axe. Doesn't really have much physical damage to go with that axe, unfortunately. So he's not really going to be able to threaten tier 3s like this Weaver can with Alacrity plus Desolator.
If they get the Tiny in there, that would be a different story. You can never underestimate the push potential of a Tiny. You just cannot base race it in any capacity because this thing will just demolish it with the Aghanim effect. If they just get one pick up top, they're going to go for it.
And just get the Void. Looking for this Jackal shot, not really needed with the Fiend's Grip in hand. And they relocate right on in on top of the tier 3 tower. K-Core and the rest of ATN is coming in from behind, but it's just the two supports while they're missing their big damage dealer. This fight could actually go really bad for ATN. Madara almost finished off El Lisash, but now he runs headlong into the Invoker with the Doom now on him. He tanks two of the big ultimate, and the rest of Advenom now have to escape. That was a very awkward counter engage there from ATN with their two supports kind of like trying to wrap back around but not really doing much since their damage dealers weren't there yet, but it does end up working out in the end with the Witch Doctor surviving, Tiny going down.
because they blew the Fiend's Grip, which I understand, they didn't expect to get the Shackles, so they get the Fiend's Grip, but because they blew the Fiend's Grip, I don't think you can fight the Doom there. I think you just hit the tower, take the tier 3 very quickly, and then blink TP out as the Tiny. And instead, he goes in for the fight, gets Doom, gets destroyed, and wonders what happened. Like, it shouldn't be a surprise that the Doom is still going to be the trump card in this situation. There's a lot of farm on alternate side, and it's not something that Tiny can fight into easily. He's much better at sieging than he is at direct combat, and unless they get, again, another big shackle shot from Thug, they just can't expect to win those kinds of fights. Unfortunately, the Tiny does go down once again, fourth death this game, and just compare that to the Weaver, 10-0-3 right now. This Weaver has had a hell of a game, doesn't seem to be dying anytime soon, and is just going to be able to build up even more damage.
Yeah, definitely been a great value pickup here for ATN. I was catching a lot of Chinese Dota, and that was definitely all the rage in China, was these fourth or fifth pick Weavers. It got to a point where Weaver actually became almost standard 3-4 ban against or for many teams.
Yeah, and it's just because it's so difficult to deal with, still so difficult to pin down. There are some heroes that are completely useless against the Weaver. In this case, they have a lot of good heroes against the Weaver, but not against Lincoln's Weaver, and that seems to be the bigger issue. You mentioned the Force Staff that can create opportunities, but
not going to get away so easily.
Relocate.
A blink for blink. Relocate out, though, is going to be able to provide the save. I like the attempt, though, from Supreme. He threw out the tornado in sort of a half-hearted attempt to catch the Wisp when he relocate leashed out. But good reaction speed there from Madara. May not have made a difference as they still blinked after him and Chronosphere, and they were able to get the save with the relocate. Probably either way, but still, a little bit of confidence booster there for Adminem as they can now go for the tier 1. Thug just backdoors it before Madara can even get there.
So, going back to the past like 10 minutes of this game, I do want to talk a little bit about the ward game and the positioning game. We've had on the Dire side, Alternate kind of defensively warded three Observer wards throughout their entry points into their jungle. Wanted to make sure that they could find safe farm, get their key items up. Now they've got those items, they've won fights spectacularly more so than they should have, honestly. With these two drafts, I think Adfenom should be the one at 5-9 kills ahead, and instead we have 19-10 in favor of Alternate. But since those Supreme, that's unfortunate.
He thought he was hiding, but he really was not.
But yeah, so from there, all those free kills led Alternate to start taking the offensive. They start getting wards in the Radiant jungle. They start playing on the Radiant side of the map when they should have been most threatened there. And Spartan, Invisrune, is that actually going to be enough? It looks like it.
I was like, how the hell? How the hell did that third attack not kill him? But looks like he invis just in time. Seriously, we really need. Because I didn't even get the sound effect out of the Invisrune being used. So I was just like, huh? But
he pushed his invulnerability button, dude.
Yeah, apparently.
Phased out of this existence, CC. Immaterial. Magnets, how do they work? I don't know. But here we've got now a big Rosh engagement. This is going to be second Rosh. All ultimates up for Alternate. I think they take this hands down, maybe a snap from Batrider. What do you think?
I think raw team fight. I think ATN still has the team fight advantage. I don't know, the AC definitely changes things a lot because now even the Wisp is a little bit harder to kill, but I think because the Wisp still doesn't have like a Ghost Scepter or something, it's so easy to kill that Madara's gonna be likely to just be kited around. We still haven't seen a good Chronosphere in quite some time, but you know what's gonna happen eventually. So I think ATN still have the advantage when it comes to the raw team fights, but Adfinum have this incredible initiation power, and they have to be able to utilize this in order to protect Roshan. Because if ATN actually get the Aegis, that means that initiation power isn't nearly as strong, right? Because then you just put your Aegis here on the high ground. But unfortunately, Adfinum do not position themselves to be able to defend something like that, and now they are gonna be able to escape, it looks like, with double TPs, but it's still rather concerning. I think ATN now just go for the end game. I think they push high ground, guaranteed with this.
Yeah, and that means Zedfinum have to start ratting. We need Madara to move towards the top lane as quickly as possible. We'll clear this way, but then he immediately moves top, starts pushing that tier 3 with the Wisp behind him. If they don't take that formation within the next, like, 20 seconds, their high ground is going to be pressed, and I'm not confident they'll be able to hold it. But they are making moves that way. While Skylark looks for Supreme in mid, this could be a free Aegis.
Could be. Nisha is sitting on the side here near the Secret Shop, picks up its point boost, has the Blink Dagger. Skylark.
I don't know.
They just really don't know where their initiation should come in. Looks like Skylark misclicked the Force Staff on himself. Maybe next time comes in from the back. He knows Weaver doesn't actually have a disable to stop him, so he's got double disables on these two, but they manage to get off the mech. Kaegor survives through that, gets off the mech. The relocate barely goes off just before the Chronosphere would have snagged the Wisp. But top lane, Thug is actually dealing a lot of damage to this tier 3 tower. He is going to be doomed up. He got Windrun off, but I don't think he escaped from this. Unless... Oh, no. Looks like Thug, yeah, he'll get back to the rest of his team. So he's good.
They might go up on the Weaver now. I mean, he does have the Liquid Sphere, but they still have the Avalanche. And oh, what?
They see him? Spartan needs help, but they managed to get the... They pop the Liquid, and now they managed to get the Lasso on him. The Exotic Deer will end up going down. That is a huge kill. 1,000 gold just for the Tiny off that Beyond Godlike spree. And ATN are desperate to catch whatever they can, but everyone from Ad Venom will be able to escape. That alone, that pickoff, and they gave up the Wisp for it too. That alone was a 2,000 gold swing.
Absolutely, that's massive. I almost looked like they were going to miss out the opportunity entirely because they Shikuchi just completely, they didn't read his movements very effectively under the Invis. But they got the kill they needed, and that also burns 2.5 minutes of Aegis time. Like, they are already half done with the Invoker Aegis, and wait only a couple more minutes, and he'll be essentially dead for free, and that's gonna allow them to open up the map a lot more. So I've been making the moves they need to keep this game alive. If the, like, say, the relocate doesn't happen bottom, then suddenly Alternate have just taken bottom lane. But because they got that relocate, because they get their opportunity on top lane with the Windranger, yeah, nice things have happened, and Abdenum are still kicking.
Skylark, Lasso about to come up. He's preemptively fireflying through everything just to be able to see if he can get the pick. I think he realized, though, that he wasn't going to find anything, so he TP's up to the top lane to stop this standard Exord Invoker Forge Spirit split push. That's going. Maybe next time he's positioned himself pretty hilariously to always backstab ATN when they go for some of these side lane pushes. Last time we saw him hanging out here, and we saw the way that was really effective when he came across with the Glimmer Cape, even though they didn't manage to pop the Doom or the Witch Doctor because they didn't one-shot the Doom, therefore he got the mech off. That was still a very effective play by him to essentially double disable both those heroes right on top of each other like that.
I really do like the Bane backstab potential because, of course, it's another way to set up relocate opportunities, but it doesn't look like Alternate are moving in full 5 formation, or at least 4 plus 1 that's able to enter into the fight pretty quickly. I'm kind of surprised that Weaver went to Heart. I don't think we've touched on this just yet, but it does get himself a raw HP pool of 2,500, which is nearly impossible to bring down, but it also gives Epinum reason to just ignore the Weaver, to start killing off everybody but, and killing off the Doom, killing off the Invoker could just make the fight for them.
Nice Chronosphere there for Nisha, gonna start targeting Spartan. Will be able to get that kill. Madara turns around with the BKB, is getting a lot of cleave damage. Skylark grabs Elisash of all the heroes and is going to pull him back. Cleave will be able to finish him off, but Madara just doesn't have the damage to fight everybody here. He's going to be chased down while Thug once again goes for this tier 3 tower. Yes, the Tiny ends up going down, but if Thug can escape, this may still be okay. Pops a Windrun, TP's out, and he's out. That was a nasty, nasty fight, but at the very least, with Thug split pushing like that, ATN will not be able to immediately get any counter objectives and have actually lost objectives of their own.
So obviously it's pretty heavy losses, death timer high on the Tiny, but they're able to deal with an Aegis, a teamfight involving Doom, Aegis, and Chrono, and still make it out without losing their base, which is probably the one thing that they needed to do here for this second Roshan. The third Rosh will still be harder because as a whole, Adfinim have lost the economy in the past 10-minute Rosh cycle, but at the very least, they haven't lost the game with it. So
yeah.
they're hanging on, and I think that they need to go for some surprise plays. I mean, as far as smokes go, they only have the one, it looks like, but they need to make sure that the Batrider... Oh, no, they have two. But they need to make sure that the Batrider can find that opportunity, kind of play the lineup to its strengths. Go for that global, go for that pickoff, and be opportunistic about it. Maybe it's ambitious, maybe alternate will just stay five, and they won't leave themselves vulnerable to something like that. But you gotta look for the opportunity, or else I think the game just plays itself out.
Yeah, I mean, retroactively, you could say that that aggression from AdVenom, like, the way that they're playing this is quite smart. That was a strategic play by them to, if a fight does occur, it's going to be on the dire side of things. In yes. which case, they're just essentially, yeah, it was a bad fight. It wasn't ideal for them by any means, but it does make the Aegis play itself out before ATN can actually go for a five-man push of their own. And in time, I really do believe is AdVenom's greatest ally. Just because, like, all of these rat strategies and the high amount of initiation they have so much pickoff potential that the more time this game plays out, the more opportunities there are for AdVenom to be able to get that clutch big pickoff that allows them to take control of the game fully. Radiant
structures are for right now, Invoker up. Moving around in Ghostwalk. The Tiny Radiant's might be caught off guard by anybody. He's looking for the Wisp. This is an even bigger pickup. Just goes Alacrity Cold Snap. Couple of hits. The Fog of War, but gets them in the end. And that is just great, because now there's nothing that allows Radiant's the Tiny to feel safe and nothing to relocate bottom.
They are going to get the pullback here on the Doom. Batrider gets over the trees. Thug was doomed up. And it looks like he may actually escape as wow. he somehow jukes all
he's
of this.
A lot
blink
of
forward.
These plays.
Thug, he's going to be hit by the Sunstrike. He only needs two more seconds to be able to get a blink of his own. He can try and go for a TP out. Oh, Chronosphere! Oh. No! Nisha! That was such a big kill if they actually get the Windranger there. The side lanes are relatively controllable. They could have gone straight down mid with that, but again,
Thug has made so many of these plays, man. Like, this yeah. is like the third time that's happened where it's just like, it should be just them following up, using their abilities, but Fog of War, man, is just insane. And maybe you could question the alternate don't really have all the best wards that they need at this moment. I mean, they have one here that controls the Roche area, and they just put that up. But otherwise, Vision has actually given them quite a bit of issue.
Counter ward is so close. Supreme almost stumbled into that trap, and it would have been so big. But now it's going to be AdVenom who are going to be the ones in the trap. Instead, they managed to get a combo onto Exotic Deer. But again, remember that heart. They don't really care too much. If they go on the Weaver, he's tanky enough to be able to endure it. So that means Invoker will take his time to be able to get the Batrider to the Bane. Also ends up being a casualty there. And you are seeing ATN, like, slowly but surely, with these kind of pickoffs, they're taking more and more control of the map. Now you look at it, and it's like all of the waves are actually pushing in for ATN, and they have the numbers advantage. This is exactly the position you need to be against the Tiny Wisp.
So it looks like Supreme has made his decision. He's been banking over 5,000 gold. Now he's going to be going for the Scythe of Vice. You've also got 3,800 on Takor's Doom. So a lot of potential for whatever he really wants. Maybe even considers an Axe, but I think the problem is he can't stay on target. So you could also look at weird item pickups like SNY just to get the movement speed, stay on top of a target. Anything that really just allows you to close distance. But closing in is Supreme onto Spartan, goes in and has a Tiny behind. A Tiny will not help, but the relocate will be there anyways.
Yeah, don't forget, Supreme. Don't forget. Deafening Blast, no longer disabled like that, so it won't stop the relocate. And our Wisp, Sayonara. Spartan's just
for
never going to get against Ghost Scepter. He needs it so badly, but I don't think he's ever going to get it.
And that's, I guess, kind of the reason the Weaver built the heart is actually to say, okay, well, I can just sit on the Wisp all day long. If you can't use the Tether Overcharge, the Relocate, to reposition and change how the fight plays out, I can just go on the Wisp, kill him off in like 4 auto attacks, no problem at all, because he's so far under-farmed, like ridiculously under-farmed. I mean, this Invoker has a Hex Aghanim's Lincoln's Drum, and the IO doesn't have one real item that you...
The pings go out! Oh, they found him! Tornado catches Thug. He's dead. He might be able to kill K-Core though before it happens. He does. His damage just too great. Oh man, Supreme is setting up all these kills, but AdVenom, you know, you can see them. They're trying really hard. to actually catch him out. They had that Gehenna Ward, you know, counter gank scenario that they were trying to set up right here. You saw maybe next time was also positioning himself around here this time around with the aggressive ward played out, but they just can't seem to get Supreme. They're just never in the right place at the right time. And even with the Doom going down, ATN are still going to be happy with that exchange.
So we just see an Aether Lens on the Batrider. He's got a good flank on Exotic Deer, but again, the hardest hero on the map to kill, and I don't even know if Relocate would be enough. I think you have to have like a Banes or a Windranger to add to that jump. Actually, Batrider just shows, cuts the wave a little, and forces out BOTs.
Not the right time there for him to pop out into lane right as the creep wave is cutting across.
Yeah, and again, I don't even know if he gets the kill even with the relocate. Like, the Tiny has a lot going for him, but this Weaver's so tanky, and he's just gonna go right in the pit, no problem at all. Monkey King bar up, and this should be Aegis and Cheese for ATM.
There's so many chances that he gets out. If he doesn't, if he, like, Shikuchi's away, right, because the Batrider didn't have gem. If he Shikuchi's away before you're able to Force Staff on the Lincolns, and then also Lasso, then Exotic Deer lives. If he survives the burst damage, he time-lapses and he lives. In fact, he's very likely to maybe actually get a turnaround kill at that point in time. It's just such a low percentage gank, but there really isn't much left for Advenim at this point in time because ATN is doing such a great job controlling this map and slowly but surely corralling Advenim back inside their base.
Yeah, I think Advenim's only option right now is base race. They can't fight Aegis, Cheese, this Weaver. Like, there's absolutely no way. The Weaver has damage and durability now. You can't just ignore him. I feel like that you have to go for the relocate top, like, pretty much pronto.
They're gonna start TPing back on ATN. They have Nisha ready to go with the Chronosphere. They can lead out with the Doom onto Thug. Maybe next time. Whoa!
Nice,
managed to Chrono up Madara and Spartan, but that does leave them exposed, as that means a Sleep and Fiendscrape combination is gonna be able to catch something here. Melee Rax is gonna be beaten down. Spartan, the relocate does last just long enough for them to do that. Madara's actually gonna be left behind here.
Weaver has no TP!
Oh dear, BKB goes down. They keep on going through the mid lane though. ATN is gonna just beat through two lanes of Rax and probably go full Megas here, as there's nothing left at this top lane. Thug is finally going to TP back, but with the Desolator, they're creaming through these buildings so quickly. Skylark's just kind of been sitting here going, guys, you know, I desperately need some damage. I can make the initiation if you want, but I need you guys to get back to base. Finally, he does get Exotic here, but no! Lincoln's blocking out the Shackle, and now Thug is not going to be able to get anything here. It gets ended up Scythe of Ice, pops the BKB, but it just doesn't matter, and ATN get Mega Creeps. One big blunder there from ATN, or Advenim rather, and that's pretty much the game. Modder's gonna try, and if he managed to actually kill everyone here, you could possibly see some sort of quick comeback going through the mid lane, but Advenim now gonna be three-man Chronosphere, Exotic Tier. He's thinking about it, but it just seems unnecessary for them to try and do this one out. Supreme blocks out that Nightmare. And the rest of ATM do get back.
Just alternate knew that they had to essentially commit. With the Weaver being unable to TP back, they just go, they actually bring the Invoker from the backline to the front, and they're like, okay, just get these racks down as quickly as possible, and the Tiny just got kited around. He could only focus on the racks so much. He does take top lane, minus 30 HP, but obviously the Mega Creeps are the bigger deal here, and Weaver just stays on the objective focus, as was his only option. Now he picks up the OTs, and that will allow him to make sure that he doesn't have to worry about the mountain breaking down his base anymore. But yeah, it's really just alternate have played this game really well. I love how they were able to open up the Radiant side of the map for themselves, because they knew Advenim would play on the Dire side in the Dire jungle. And from there, they were able to find a little bit of kill advantage, and a lot of farm advantage that allowed them to get to this point of the game, where now they have absolutely nothing to fear. Advenim, they need a miracle to bring themselves back. It just doesn't seem possible.
Yeah, you could see the last 15 minutes has just been incrementally going downwards and downwards and downwards for ATN as they find a pick up and farm, control the map. Pick up, farm, control the map. And every single time they successfully did that, the noose just got a little bit tighter for Advenim until, you know, there was eventually going to be a screw up of some kind, and, you know, those kind of drastic plays where you're trying to go for the trade-offs. What's going to happen? If Spartan had brought back Madara, maybe they wouldn't be fighting up against Mega Creeps right now. I think that was simply a misclick there from Spartan. I don't think he intended to leave Madara. I'm not sure, but...
I mean, like, you're kind of desperate, you kind of want to leave him, but you really can't afford that play. Because, you know, if the Weaver is not TPing back, he's going to commit to everything. You have to fall back. Essentially, what that Relocate does is get... Oh, never mind. We'll see the final fight here.
Chrono on three. Catches Spartan with the fourth. The Meteor's going to drop Deafening Blast, and that is most assuredly game over for Advenom. It doesn't matter how many buybacks you have. ATN will take game number one. Very nicely played by them. The control was just beautiful. Advenom seemed to struggle to get the pickoffs. And I think there were some moments of luck, yes, where there's moments where Supreme just was never caught out by the attempted ganks from Advenom, where they set up these kind of traps. You know, Supreme never stumbled into those. But as a whole, the Supreme was able to always be there in a position to, you know, he was never looking for the Tiny. He was always searching for the Wisp first, getting those picks.